Welcome to this debate, ladies and gentlemen, on the merits or otherwise of modern architecture. I think most of you, probably because I've seen some of you here before, know what the rules are of the evening, but just in case you don't, I'll explain. We use normal debating rules where we have three speakers for, three speakers against. They will all speak for 8 to 9 minutes. I will be quite severe with them and make them sum up absolutely on time. And as you came in, you were asked to vote. So what we will do is announce that vote when the speakers have stopped speaking. Then we will go to the audience and throw the whole debate open, and you can ask questions, you can make points. I hope you won't make speeches that are too long, because usually quite a lot of people want to speak. And it's very nice within that 40 minutes when we go to the audience to get as many of you contributing as possible. Then when we've opened it to the floor, you vote. And you all have a card with for and against on it. If you're very clear and you want to vote for or against, tear your card in two and put the appropriate piece in the box that they bring round. If you still haven't decided which side you're on, then put your whole ticket in. Then whilst the speakers are summing up, and they have 2 minutes each to sum up at the end, we will be counting those votes again and see how they have swayed you or not in favour or against the motion. And the motion tonight is, as I said, on the merits or otherwise of modern architecture, whether modern architecture is a series of great erections to the egos of even greater architects, or whether they're emblems of the enormous creativity of our culture, or perhaps they're both. Our first speaker this evening is Roger Scruton. He's a philosopher, public commentator. He's currently a research professor for the Institute of Psychological Sciences, and he teaches philosophy at the graduate school in both Washington and Oxford. He's well known as a conservative thinker and a very powerful polemicist, and lots of other things. And I know you go hunting as well, Roger, and you love the countryside. Lots of other things I could say about you, but most of you have got the notes. Roger Scruton. Just to read for you, the topic for debate is Prince Charles was right, modern architecture is still all glass stumps and carbuncles.
It would be foolish to deny that there are beautiful modern buildings, whether secular like the houses of Frank Lloyd Wright or sacred like the chapels at Anchan and Vence. The debate, however, concerns the rule, not the exceptions. The complaint issued against modern architecture by the Prince of Wales and many others concerns the ordinary buildings which have recently sprung up in our towns, which seem designed not to fit in, but to stand out. The modern office block, apartment house, or public building is not made for the city, but against it, like the spiral proposed by Libeskind for the V&A, which you see on the screen. Architects have become careless of the city and its inhabitants, more concerned to draw attention to themselves and their creations than to fit modestly into their surroundings as good manners demand. And the result is seen by the rest of us as a threat, comparable to loud-mouthed insolence on the buses or drunken puking in the street. Discussion of this issue should begin, I think, from common sense principles, and I'll suggest three of them. The first is that we build in order to dwell, and to dwell is to dwell among neighbours who have as great an interest in how we build as we have ourselves. A town is a home where strangers settle side by side and enjoy a shared sense of belonging. Its streets are public spaces, and the facades of its buildings stand in a personal relation to all who pass them by. The second principle is that genius is as rare among architects as it is among the rest of us. Most buildings will be the creation of talentless people who are simply doing a job like you and me. The less they try to be original and expressive, the better. To pretend to these qualities in their absence is to jettison the three most important social virtues, which are modesty, humility, and the ability to act as though others are more important than yourself. Most of our beautiful towns were not the work of architects, but of modest builders, working with materials that they understood and on a scale that does not challenge our perceptions. The third principle follows. Buildings should fit together in a public space that is accessible and friendly to all of us. This is most easily achieved if there is a shared repertoire of details, materials that blend and do not come apart visually at the joints, and proportions that can be emulated by each new addition to the townscape. And here, I hope, is an example of what I mean. I apologize for the slides, I'm an amateur. This is a simple street in Whitby, executed in the vernacular classical idiom, which was the common property of builders from the late 17th century until the time when modernist effrontery swept it away. Nobody knows who built these houses, and nobody cares. They were put up at different times for different purposes, using the local brick and with parts made to order by local carpenters and timber merchants. They are not great works of art, but there is a restfulness, a day-to-day gentleness of manners, which makes it make it a pleasure to walk beside them. This is a welcoming street. The windows and doors, being taken from pattern books, harmonize with each other. The gutters and downpipes make a pleasant fugue from house to house, and the sky is not punctured and scratched as it is by the junk that is piled up on so many modern buildings, but it spreads like a canopy from roof to roof and chimney to chimney. You see a street light attached to the wall of one of the houses. It is expressed in the same classical language as the houses. It is not an excrescence, but a solid piece of street furniture, emphasizing the emotional reality of this street as both a public space and a home. These houses are not overtly classical. There are no Palladian windows, no pilasters or cornices, just the faintest hint of an order in the unobtrusive string courses, which make such a pleasing contrast with the slope of the street. They hint at a kind of beauty which they neither achieve nor attempt, like a note struck on a piano in which all the harmonics of the triad can be faintly heard. And here, by way of contrast, is a street in Bristol, on one side of which is a row of buildings in the classical vernacular style, on the other side a collection of buildings in the modernist vernacular, using curtain walls of glass and laminated panelling. The detailing on the left-hand side of the street, where it exists, is visual nonsense. The surfaces have no perceivable relation to the structure, which is hidden behind them. The buildings have no posture and no real relation to the passerby. They abut against each other arbitrarily, like aggressive people jostling in a crowd. They stick out at will and without visual reason. There is a kind of grammarless chaos here, of a kind that can be witnessed everywhere in our towns. Now, I envisage the response that I am demanding too much. After all, these buildings are designed as offices. They have a specific use, which dictates their shape, and all that we see is the outer shell of a space that in itself is perfectly adapted to its purpose. But there is an obvious reply to that. The houses on the right are also offices. They were designed as private houses, but because they are so well-mannered, the residents of Bristol campaigned for their preservation. And they serve their new purpose perfectly, just as they would serve any purpose in which civility is needed. The buildings on the left, by contrast, could never serve any purpose but that for which they were built. And that purpose they will fulfill badly, precisely because those condemned to work in them will never be able to regard them as a home. It is inconceivable that anyone should wish to convert one of them to private apartments, a university, or a church. They will continue to be offices until the day, not very long hence, when they will have to be demolished at great financial and environmental cost. By that time, the houses on the right will have found another use, as a school, perhaps, or a theatre. Here is the only cheerful aspect of modern architecture. Okay, let me emphasize that I'm not talking about the masterpieces. I'm talking about ordinary buildings in our cities. And I'm saying that the modern archetypes, which are designed at a computer and very often look like one, show no respect for their surroundings. They jut into the fabric of the town, often destroying the line of the street or making violent assaults on the skyline. All too often, the effect is of an assemblage of modern buildings in a city is like this vignette of modern Amsterdam, taken at random on a recent visit. The piece of railway architecture in the foreground does not stand as a building stands. It's like a plastic gadget washed up between two unsightly blocks of concrete, a kind of symbolic representation of the rubbish that can be neither recycled nor composted, but which will remain forever as a sign of how our generation of wastrels has trashed the planet. By contrast, here is a Victorian railway building, once a siding shed at Rochford. People have liked it and therefore kept it, and it is now a restaurant and conference centre. This is a symbol not of waste, but of the careful husbandry of resources, a long-term and cheerful settlement of the land, not for this generation or this moment, but forever. And that forever is written in the arches and mouldings which belong to the ageless language of design. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Roger, for getting us off to such a very good start. Now, the first speaker against the motion is Stephen Bailey, who is perhaps one of the best-known authorities on design, architecture, popular culture and taste. And he was educated, luckily for him, at Manchester University. In the 80s, of course, he set up the Boiler House Project with Terence Conran, and they put on many imaginative exhibitions there. Clive James has said of him, he has the knack of getting ahead of everybody with values that turn out to be permanent. Stephen Bailey.
Thank you. Thank you, and good evening. Well, you can, as the Prince of Wales is reputed to do, talk to plants, but it's always a bit of a one-sided conversation because they tend not to talk back. I think the scope of inquiry with a rose or a potato is relatively limited. But buildings, on the other hand, I think are much more sophisticated, subtle, and multi-layered. With buildings, conversations evolve over time, and the tone of these conversations changes according to weather and experience. You can interrogate a building, and sometimes they interrogate you back. Anyway, we're all very grateful to the Prince of Wales, certainly for his thoughts on gardening and farming, but I genuinely believe that his simplistic, hierarchical, single-path criticism of modern architects and modern architecture has done no one any good. I mean, one example from his intrusion in the so-called debate is the puerile name-calling, which began with carbuncles and stumps. This catchpenny glib nursery culture has caught on and now masquerades as architectural criticism. Large new buildings are reduced to a crude morphological metaphor, so you have walkie-talkies and cheese graters and gherkins and so on. Should anybody be really surprised that after this most influential of architecture critics brands complex structures with shapely insults, that so many architects have responded by delivering a succession of shallow one-liners? It's like when your wife calls you a lousy, two-timing, no good, ne'er-do-well. There's very little to prevent you being so. But anyway, the point is, the motion, let's get back to the motion. What Roger Scruton said was interesting and articulate, but actually avoided the subject we're here to discuss. The motion is that modern architecture is all glass stumps and carbuncles. That's manifestly not the case. So the actual proposal can be immediately disposed of. There are superb examples of modern architecture, nothing of the sort. Le Corbusier, of course, Hans Scheroen's classic Berlin, concert hall, just to give another example. More recently, some fine housing in Cambridge by Field and Clegg Bradley. There's lots of it. Even the so often demonized Le Corbusier hardly ever made a glass stump, and when he did, it's universally admired, like the handsome United Nations in New York. But anyway, Roger Scruton so helpfully conceded that there was some talent in Corb. But let's be clear, I think, that the actual wording of the motion disguises the real debate. The real subject here is hatred of novelty and experimentation. The real beliefs of the proposers are that culture is stagnant, even dead. And of course, that's the way they prefer it. Excellence, they believe, only can exist in the past. What a dreadfully depressing psychology it is to be so fearful of the future and so dismissive of the present. This is what the Prince of Wales has given us: silly metaphors and a distrust of creativity. Of course, no one but a fool would deny that lots of utterly atrocious modern buildings have been made in the past century. But so too were lots of atrocious buildings made in other centuries. But they've been lost, and it's the phenomenon known as survival bias that muddles the Prince of Wales's view of history. And besides, none of the historic buildings so admired by the gang that's going to save us from the future, none of these actual builders, the jobbing builders who, to whom Roger Scruton referred, none of them would recognize the timorous conservatism suggested by this motion. What then are the Prince of Wales's own credentials? Well, the original Carbuncles feature 25 years ago led to the current National Gallery extension. For one example, a design as vacuous as it is pretentious, and one not at all well adapted to its purpose. Another example, and I hope it's not sort of lèse majeste to disclose a personal anecdote, but 20 years ago, as Anna Ford said, I was busy finishing off London's Design Museum. We went to the Prince of Wales to ask him to open it. I gave what I thought was a reasonably eloquent account of the importance of design to the economy and to the culture, about national purpose. The Prince of Wales, these larger issues interested him not at all. He just looked at me dolefully and he said, "Mr. Bailey, why has it got a flat roof?" There wasn't, I think, a scintilla of intellectual inquiry or architectural knowledge. And then, of course, there is, talking of that, Poundbury. To continue the literary theme with which I began, Poundbury is doggerel and pastiche. It's uninspired, craven, and derivative. It is sham, fake, and bogus. Now, we don't like these qualities much in writing or in people. Why would we admire these things in buildings and townscape? And what, too, of the inconsistent anachronisms in the Prince of Wales' arguments? One notes that His Royal Highness does not visit Dorset in 18th-century helicopters. Metopes, guttae, and triglyphs are all very well for those who want them, but we make buildings with different building technology today. Besides, no one speaks Attic Greek anymore. You know, the best truth I know about architecture is that you don't finish a building. You start it. And the same goes for towns. And if Poundbury is anything to go by, the Prince of Wales is not right. He is very, very wrong. The assumption in the design of the Prince of Wales' pet architectural project is that architecture is finished. We all know everything we need to know. And all we need to do, as Roger Scruton suggested, is copy the past. And frankly, it gets copied in a rather illiterate fashion. The architectural future, as seen by the proposers of this motion, is not to be Carbuncles and Stumps, but it's going to be fakes and forgeries. Anyway, thank you. But my real concern with the Prince's negativism and the negativism inherent in the motion is that wanting to make things new and better is, I believe, a defining characteristic of civilization. The proposers in this motion represent the first moment in history when thoughtful men hid in the past. I guess they've all read Lampedusa's great novel, The Leopard, where the hero looks out of the rubble of his collapsing palazzo and he says, if you want things to stay the same, they're going to have to change. Such a pity that they don't recognize the profound truth in this. Modern architecture, as I say, is manifestly not all Carbuncles and Stumps. It's not even a style, it's an attitude. It's a belief in making the most of contemporary possibilities. It's not about destroying history, instead it learns from the past, but has the confidence not to ape it. No one denies, least of all not me, that there are very many very bad modern buildings, but they're bad because they're bad. They're not bad because they're new. The Prince of Wales is absolutely right to condemn poor design, but he's wrong to condemn modern architecture. To do so is to condemn the creative spirit, and I therefore oppose the motion. Thank you.
Well, I wonder how you voted when you came in and whether you're wavering already. Our next speaker for the motion is Simon Jenkins, who's an author and a journalist. Of course, he's edited The Times and The Evening Standard. He's written numerous books, one of them on the architecture of London and the development of London, and others on England's 1,000 best churches and England's 1,000 best houses. Simon.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Stephen, for your splendid speech. It's the first time I felt I ought to impose a listed building order on a speech. paper abuse. We've been very restrained on our side of the house this evening. I haven't got any slides. I did think, mischievously, of getting a photographer to go out and photograph all the buildings in which opponents of this motion have lived and moved and had their being throughout their lives, but it would have been expensive, and I'm sure that they're very true to their principles, and they all live in concrete blighted stump somewhere off the East India Dock Road, where some Corbusian from the Association of Architects felt it would be good for the working classes to live. The essential point I want to make this evening is that the architecture which I think we're discussing has always been unpopular. We are discussing modern architecture, in my view, not with a capital M, with a small m, but with a capital M. It's the style of architecture which evolved between the wars in Germany, out of the abstract minimalist movement, and was characterized by a rejection of all forms of style, and has proved remarkably vigorous, at least within architectural schools and the architectural profession itself, but remarkably unvigorous among those people who choose to choose their own places to live and work. If you go out along the Great West Road, you'll see the works of the interwar Ideal Home Exhibition, neo-Tudor suburbs, neo-Georgian suburbs, neo-Queen Anne suburbs. But there's a wonderful moment somewhere in East Acton, for connoisseurs of these subjects, where you'll see a row, actually facing the road out to the airport, of about four neo-Bauhaus structures, clearly the result of some bright spark coming back to the New Ideal Home, Homes Association, I think they were called, and suggesting that maybe this year we could break away from neo-Tudor, neo-Georgian, neo-Queen Anne and put up something made of pre-stressed concrete or render with a flat roof, no nonsense about a porch, and metal windows. It was abundantly clear that as soon as anyone from the public saw this structure, they said, but the flat roof will leak, we need a porch to stop the draft getting in, and metal windows rust. Not a single one of them sold, and the evidence of that is, if you look at them, that every one of them has now got a huge Queen Anne roof plonked on top of it, looking absolutely ludicrous, but presumably in order to get it to sell. There are only, in my view, two groups of people who've taken to the modern movement. One is public sector housing, since the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Because those people who were ordering public sector housing knew for sure they wouldn't have to live in it, and formed a peculiar and, in my view, pernicious alliance with the products of the architectural academies at the time to build in the style that Le Corbusier and others, who is, I think, rightly castigated as the progenitor of most of this movement, to produce a utopian new society which would, in a sense, be social engineering through architecture. Now, I won't go over the products of their endeavors. They are being demolished all over the world. They were particularly prominent in Eastern Europe for obvious reasons. Interestingly, when they were being demolished in Liverpool, under the militant tendency of all people, the militant tendency, despite their otherwise predispositions, did actually ask the people of Liverpool where they'd like to live. The people of Liverpool, at least along Vauxhall Road, said they would like to live in the sorts of places they used to live in before they were demolished. And they have reconstructed a sort of neo-Queen Anne vernacular, which is extremely charming, is very popular, and is the absolute contrast of what the Liverpool Architects Department under Shankland had built in the 1960s and 70s. If you ask people where they want to live, they do not choose the modern movement. The other group who have proved very susceptible to the modern movement are essentially those people who build very large office blocks in city centers in the hope that they will thereby attract a tenant who wants an icon to his or her commercial prowess. Again, the motive here is ostentation, show, demonstrativeness, not utility or even popularity. The tall buildings that went up in London in the 70s and 80s and attracted Prince Charles's scorn, Centre Point, the Euston Tower, Stag Place, were essentially buildings fashioned by planners with architects in collusion in order to get profit out of busting the building code and build an underpass or a roundabout supposedly to benefit the public. They were universally unpopular, and almost all of them had to be taken by the only employer that doesn't give a damn about its employees, the government. Interestingly, when the inhabitants of these buildings get rich and get to choose where to do their work, the hedge fund managers, the private equity capitalists moving out of the city, where do they go? They go to a nice Georgian house in Mayfair. They know what they really like, and I think we do too. Now, the outcome of this, as far as I'm concerned, is that it's authority. It's always authority that imposes modern architecture. It is not bottom-up demand that requires it. And I think there's a reason for this. Deep in our cultural DNA, there is a love of ornament. 2 minutes. We like decoration. We like style. There is something about style, proportion, that appeals to us. We resonate with it. That is why wherever anybody builds a housing estate or even a commercial estate, they find that the people want the traditional motifs, the designs, the echoes of the past. And I find that extremely significant when I'm viewing the modern minimalist glass box or concrete stump architecture. It is simply not what we respond to. The Victorians understood this. The Victorians, knowing they were tearing apart their communities, their society, deliberately took refuge in the styles of the past. They did not build reproduction. They developed, they thought, they did variations on the styles of the past. But they built what I believe to be some of the greatest buildings in Britain, Victorian architecture. I don't agree with everything Prince Charles says, but on this thing, he was right. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon. Our next speaker against the motion is Alain de Botton. He is a philosopher, an essayist. He's written numerous books, really about the philosophy of everyday life, how Proust can change your life. His most latest book is The Architecture of Happiness, which discusses questions of beauty and ugliness in architecture. Alain.
There was clearly a lot of wonderful architecture in the past. Here's the Villa Rotonda, here's the Rue de Castiglione, and there's a lot of appalling architecture in the modern day. This is a convention center in Malaysia. This is the view from my window. I don't live in it, but I live, it's true, I do live in a traditional house, but this is the view from it, and it's appalling. This is where I stayed a couple of weeks ago. This is the Travel Lodge near Colchester, not a place to be recommended. I remember lying on that bed and dreaming of this place, Cathedral in Reims, and thinking how lovely it would be if only the Travel Lodge had taken that over. This has led a lot of very well-meaning and otherwise intelligent people to suppose that we must clearly build a little bit in this sort of spirit. We must go back in time because clearly the masters of the past knew how to build. This idea has been very influential, as I say, among some people. It captured the mind of a completely insane Japanese property developer who a few years ago traveled the medieval Netherlands, or rather looked at the architecture of the medieval Netherlands, and thought, well, it's so beautiful, why don't I take a little bit of this and bring it back home to Japan? So this is the suburbs of Nagasaki, it's also a reproduction of some of the choicest parts of, the medieval Netherlands. This is not Amsterdam, it's, Nagasaki. There's something clearly very wrong here. It's got nothing to do with the individual building, clearly very well finished, very well detailed, bricks imported from the Netherlands, etc. It's got to do with the fact that these buildings have forgotten where they are. It seems very important that a building remembers two things. A, where it is, B, what the time is. Let me look at the where it is bit. I'm a great fan of light switches. Whenever I go to a hotel and arrive in a foreign country, I love to look at the light switches, and I love to take photographs of them. Very strange person I am. If you look at the image on this image here, you'll notice that, you might notice that this is a Swiss light switch, and when you hit that, you know you're in Switzerland. That somehow that light switch has captured some of the key qualities of Swiss, the Swiss way of life. This light switch is, of course, a North American light switch. Again, when you hit that, you know you're in the States. There's nothing more depressing when you travel abroad than when you go to a place like this. It could be anywhere. It could be in Denver, it could be in Georgia, in Atlanta. It's in fact downtown Tokyo, but you don't know where it is. In other words, we want an architecture that somehow alludes to its place through its use of materials and through the language of its design. Not only do we need an architecture that remembers the place, we also need to find an architecture that remembers what the time is. This is a building that's really forgotten what the time is. This is a building that was built in 1992, or was it 1750? We don't know. It's in Poundbury, and it houses a group of IT workers who work down the road. There's clearly something going on here that makes us uncomfortable. It reminds us, in a way, of Nagasaki, as does this, a building by Quinlan Terry in Regent's Park. However finely detailed it may be and well-made, it's somehow speaking to us of the wrong things. Architecture and works of design speak. They speak of politics, our way of life, a way of ordering society. Take a couple of tea sets. If you had to put politics to this, this is left wing. This is right wing. This rides a bicycle. This drives a top-end Mercedes. I'm joking, but what we can see is in the simplest works of design, there is a spirit. And I think when we're choosing buildings or just tea sets, we often want a kind of work of design that reflects our own ideals. Take some taps. All of them have a character. You could turn all of them into people, and they would have a distinct character. If you had to go on holiday with any one of them, I'd choose probably this one. We all very clearly recognize that there is a spirit to works of design. Now, what's wrong with modern the idea that we can go backwards in time and build things of an old spirit today? Well, this is some of the problem. This is the Schlossbrücke, designed by Schinkel, classical architect in Berlin. Goes up in 1824. This is his Altes Museum. Again in Berlin. Now, when Schinkel built this, he wanted us to think about the values of ancient Greece and Rome. That's why he built like this. I think it's the values of ancient Greece and Rome are in many ways admirable, but they are also in certain key ways anachronistic. In other words, if we build buildings that speak to us of the values of ancient Greece and Rome, we will have an awkward shift of gear when we walk out of these buildings into a world of modern IT systems and office life and also family life, which has changed incomparably since these buildings were originally designed. We need buildings to capture the modern spirit. What does that mean? This is a modern building. This is a set of modern buildings. This is the Finnish pavilion at the Seville Expo in 1992. It summons up an image of Finland, which is both recognizably modern and rooted in tradition. This is Brasilia, Oscar Niemeyer's capital in Brazil. Most of Brazil looks nothing like this. However, this is a picture, an image that Brazilians wanted to build for themselves, promising themselves what their future might look like. We seem to be in danger of going backwards and somehow idealizing a past which simply doesn't fit the reality of the present. We're in danger of doing a Marie Antoinette. This was Marie Antoinette's toy village at the bottom of the Garden of Versailles, where she went to recapture the spirit of the olden days and of the peasant rural life. The only people who live like this are not peasants. We are obsessed by a peasant architect because we're frightened of the modern world. We haven't found a way of making ourselves at home in the modern world, and so we run away to this. There is a timidity. By the way, a lot of Barrett housing looks a little bit like this. There is a timidity to this kind of architecture. I'm saying that we should try and make ourselves at home in modernity. There are examples of Japanese buildings, for example. I showed you some Japanese buildings that didn't fit their time or place. These are some Japanese buildings that I think is a modern, a very wealthy Japanese, Simon Jenkins was saying that no wealthy modern people want to live in modern architecture. Well, they do. This is a top stockbroker in Tokyo. Where does he live? He lives in a building that is both modern and attuned to the past. This is a man who's made a fortune in IT in Tokyo. Where does it, just outside Tokyo, where does he live? In a modern building that remembers the past. Here are some other examples of buildings that are modern but remember the past. This is the Yale Center for British Art, done by Louis Kahn. This is a villa for an extremely rich American who's decided to live here. Very attractive kind of architecture. Herzog and de Meuron building for another very wealthy couple who have chosen, not by a diktat of the state, but by their own free choice, to live here. Of course, there is such a thing as pastiche when you're doing modern buildings. This is Georgian architecture. This is bad, fake Georgian architecture. What we want is not to imitate the past slavishly, but to take inspiration from it. This is Michael Hopkins's Queen's building in Cambridge. This is a building that is both recognizably modern and attuned to the past. That's what I'm arguing for, an architecture that doesn't hide, that doesn't feel that we shouldn't develop land, that takes inspiration from the way that the architects of Venice turned this into this. And they did so not by being afraid of modernity. This was an extremely modern building in its day. And what I'm arguing against the motion for is the idea that we should not be frightened of drawing from the past, but making something distinctive and attuned to the spirit and the needs of the present. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker for the motion is Leon Krier, who is an architect and urban planner, and he's been one of the most influential neo-traditional architects and planners. He's best known, of course, for his development of Poundbury, with Prince Charles, which I think Stephen Bailey referred to as dongrel and pastiche, sham, fake, and bogus. But Leon has written lots of books. He's joined the office of James Stirling in the 68 to 74, and his latest book is Architecture, Choice or Fate. Leon.
Thank you, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm always stunned by the shallowness of the critiques which are addressed to the Prince of Wales. When you see the film of Michael Fran, he appears to be an idiot. In any documentation I have seen on him, he appears to be a very shallow person, and also in the speakers who are against the motion, he appears to be a nitwit. I am not a royalist, I never was, but I remember I think most of you here remember incredibly the moment when he made that speech at the RIBA conference at Hampton Court. He was invited by the RIBA, and I'm thankful that the RIBA should come back to the subject, because what the Prince of Wales did was actually give voice to something, a terrible feeling of, an ill feeling of uncomfort and despair about architecture, which nobody dared to express. Indeed, many people don't even dare to express it now. Mitterrand had become the great defender of neo-modernism, and the Prince of Wales became the defender of traditional architecture. Now, we live in democracy, and it should be considered that these positions, which are very different, that they belong to the same time, and you don't have to say that you reach back to the past and that you have a simplistic mind if you speak English. We all speak English here, and that is, you know, we could say we just reach back to the past. How can we use a language which has been spoken in the past? Now, traditional architecture, and I know, I have been knowing the Prince now for 22 years. I've worked for him for 20 years. He was my fourth client in England, and all my colleagues said, you must refuse this job by Charlie expletive, you know. I said to the first employer, James Stirling, but he is my only client in this damn country. You know, why should I refuse him? In 20 years' experience, I have never seen anything approaching of his image in public. It appears to be simplistic. Now, to do in a situation where we are a culture of synthetics, an industrial culture entirely based that our specificity is entirely signified and characterized by our excessive use of fossil fuels. Without the use of fossil fuels, there is no modernism. There is only modernity. Now, the mistake of modernism is to take itself for the only legitimate representative of modernity, and all the rest, they just belong to the past. They are ridiculous. Now, all the people who live in traditional houses are then idiots and ridiculous. They look back into the past. It's, of course, this doesn't stand to scrutiny. And yet these incredibly childish arguments, they dominate education, they dominate the media, they dominate indeed the architectural scene. Most of the teaching in this country, you can actually not learn traditional architecture in this country in any school. Traditional architecture, in its definition, is a technology of building with natural materials and fitting natural material in such a way that they stand up. It's not a style of the past, it's a technology. Now, to historicize a technology using natural materials is, of course, rejecting an entire branch of man-made environment as being a matter of the past, and you cut yourself from the roots. It's like saying, if you speak English, you are not a modern person. It's of the same nature. Now, all the Prince did is to open a possibility for traditional architecture to be practiced again. Now, in a situation where industry produces a synthetic culture with synthetic methods and synthetic materials, it is extremely difficult to work with architects who have not been trained to design traditional buildings. To do a traditional town is almost impossible. It's much more difficult than to design a decent modernist building. So the condition to produce this is not an easy one, and the Prince of Wales has not taken an easy step into doing this. His own organization was against it. They complotted for 4 years before this became possible in order not to do it, and he stuck through it. I had many clients before the Prince of Wales, and whenever there was the slightest difficulties with the media, they would immediately give up, because of course, who wants bad publicity? And the Prince of Wales stuck it through. He's truly, I'm not a royalist, I say it again, but he's a heroic character who, through his action, is giving royalty in this country a legitimacy it didn't have. And it has a tragic side to it. And it's to be taken extremely seriously. I can also promise you that he has stuck through it, and the next phase of Poundbury will be authentically built. It will not just be decently built with natural materials, but it will be structurally also coherent. Now, anyone who goes to that place and pretends that it's Disneyland doesn't know Disneyland. No, Disneyland, if you go to Disneyland and Disney World, also has always a side of modernism. You may have forgotten this. You know, Epcot and so on was a vision of the future. Yet, it's only the historicist or the kind of traditionalist imitations which are accused of being of the Disney world. Yeah. So I think that traditional architecture is going to come back extremely soon. It's already upon us. With the increase in fossil fuel costs and so on, we have to go back to natural materials. We have to go back to pedestrian cities vertically and horizontally. And this is going to be the condition of the future, and architects have to learn again to fit natural materials in ways which are pleasant. And I think the Prince of Wales has been showing the way. To simplify the thing, traditional architecture is not a style. It's as many styles as there are landscapes, as there are climatic conditions, and it is an extremely rich polyglot language. Modernism, instead, is a single man's language. It's a new speak which purely can only exist with synthetic materials, and it will die with the increasing cost of synthetic materials. Thank you.
Thank you. Our final speaker, against the motion, is Sean Griffiths, who is founding director of the architectural practice FAT, Fashion Architecture Taste. It's very provocative architecture that he believes in. It explores issues of taste and communication. He's also visiting professor, Louis Kahn, visiting professor of architecture at the Yale School of Architecture. Sean Griffiths.
Oh my God, what is there left to say on this subject? I think it was May the 17th, 1984, that the Prince of Wales mounted this famous attack on the architectural profession and on modern architecture in particular. 4 months after that, I enrolled on an architecture course. I've got some grey hairs, you might notice. At the not particularly glamorous Manchester Polytechnic. Not surprisingly, the drafting rooms of that illustrious institution were full of the talk of the Prince's speech. And as we donned our smoking jackets and retired to the comfort of the leather armchairs of Nelson Mandela House, as the Students' Union was then known, we lit our cigars and pondered the question, is the Prince right about modern architecture? Of course, we did not smoke cigars in the leather armchairs of Manchester Polytechnic. It was run by the Revolutionary Communist Party at the time. Nor did we give much thought to the Prince's views on modern architecture. In fact, I think it's fair to say, and excuse my modernist uncouthness, but I think it's fair to say we didn't give a shit about the Prince of Wales' views on architecture. There were actually far more important things going on. So my question tonight is not, was the Prince right about modern architecture? Is why the hell are we still talking about this 24 years later? It's not as even in 1984 that the prince was at the leading edge of the debate. Modernism was not the reigning orthodoxy in 1984. Postmodernism and neoclassicism reigned. By 1984, postmodernism was itself under attack from a new generation. I think this... No, it doesn't work. Aha! It does work eventually. Here we go. This is a work by Zaha Hadid, recent recipient of the Pritzker Prize. First woman to ever receive the Pritzker Prize, interestingly. You'll notice there's only one woman on the top table tonight. This was done in 1982 as a reaction against postmodernism. So what the prince was exhibiting in 1984 was really how utterly out of fashion he was, and I think probably not for the first time. And you may laugh and say, well, fashion, what has that got to do with it? And fashion is very much a dirty word in architecture. It has nothing to do with architecture. And if there's one thing that unites architects, modern and traditional, it is a view that architecture and fashion have nothing to do with each other. But architecture is responsive to fashion and does change as fashions change. So architectural styles go in and out of fashion. So to exclude one particular architectural style as not the spirit of the age or not appropriate seems to me completely ridiculous in an age of pluralism. Here's an example. Trellick Tower, you see it on the West Way, you see it as you come in from Paddington Station. Exactly the type of thing that the Prince of Wales was attacking. And certainly at the time it was very, very unpopular. But now it's hugely popular. In fact, if you tried to buy an apartment in one of these towers now, you probably wouldn't be able to afford it, or at least I wouldn't, because I'm just a mere architect. Similarly, this building, the Barbican, that's another Trellick Tower, the Barbican complex. Now, this is a prime example of modern architecture, not designed by a very famous architect, designed by a very competent firm of commercial architects called Chamberlain Bond Powell. And this isn't at all a kind of a sort of canonical example, and exhibits all of the qualities of modernism. It has a certain kind of planning which is not based on the street. It has a form of construction which is certainly not traditional. And I find myself actually agreeing with Leon quite a lot, as one of the two architects, that craft is really important. And this is a fantastically crafted building. I walk through it a lot. And the quality of the concrete work is quite astounding. And these buildings are the sort that I think Simon Jenkins was attacking recently in a Guardian article he wrote, calling for the demolition of Robin Hood Gardens, which is a building by the Smithsons in the East End of London. He described Trellick Tower as intrusive, and I'm sure he feels in a similar way about this kind of thing. And he described new brutalism somewhat sneeringly as something that its creators were proud of, this brutality. The point I'm trying to make is that Simon and his colleagues over there mightn't like this stuff, but there are actually lots of people who do. Similarly, these buildings, if you want to buy a two-bedroom flat in this complex, you won't get much change out of £1 million. That's how popular it is. Okay, and so what I'm trying to say is that fashions change. Something that was unpopular at one time becomes popular later, and so you shouldn't dismiss it. The point I really wanted to make, I think, which goes back to what I was saying at the beginning, was that this argument about styles is actually irrelevant. We should be talking about quality. And I said that we weren't really interested in debating the argument about the prince in architecture school in 1984, because at that time we were busy organising protests against the government of the time, which, as you will remember, was run by Margaret Thatcher. And what was going on at that time, and we're still experiencing the results of that, was a promotion of the free market, where all values to do with the public good, with the idea of architecture or any other profession being some kind of noble calling for the public good, was being thrown out in favour of a series of values that were to do with business. And we're living with the consequences of that today, the New Labour project, of course, being a continuation of Thatcherism. And this, not any kind of debate about style, is the issue we should be talking about. Because we have these hideous procurement systems called design and build, called PFI, which are delivering the most revolting, cheaply made, poor space standards in which our kids are going to be educated, in which if you're ill, you're going to be incarcerated, and if you're really unlucky, you get to live in a product of these systems. And these are the things we should be talking about, not some kind of stupid debate about one style or another. So what I'm calling for tonight is that this is the swan song of this debate, and can we please talk about something a little bit more important? Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to thank all the speakers for keeping within their time limit. And it would be really kind if you could do that too when you speak. Now, I've got the result of the voters who came in, and I wonder whether you've changed your minds and who has been the most influential speaker you've heard this evening. The result so far is, before the debate, those in favour of the motion, 199, those against the motion, 365, and don't knows, 119. So let me throw the debate open to the floor now. There are microphones wandering about, so will you wait until a microphone comes, and would you tell us, out of interest, who you are and maybe what you do if you feel like it? Yes.
My name's Sarah Cook. My question is for Leon. On Sunday, the Prince of Wales announced a £1 billion initiative to develop eco-friendly cities in Great Britain. Now, this is a brilliant piece of urban planning and something that is so essential. Why on earth shouldn't the exteriors match the brilliance of the technology and the interiors that will be required to create these astounding buildings? And there's no conflict between using natural materials and modern design.
Thank you. Leon, would you like to answer that?
I think the idea of an ecological technology is still futuristic because it doesn't exist yet. But what we know is that the future will not be high tech. That is absolutely, it will be, high tech will be reduced to a very small crowd of people of which you have an inkling a bit in ex-Soviet Russia or in totally inegalitarian societies. The cost of fossil fuels, and when you think about the importance of fossil fuels on everything we have been doing, on each one of our lives, you read the book by Künstler about the long emergency, and you will change your thinking. There's absolutely the confusion which exists today of modernism and modernity is still with you. You have to think that modernity has nothing to do with style. We are all modern, whether we like it or not. Modernity is not a condition of style of high or low tech. It's a presence, its existence, unavoidable, and we can't help it. But ecological design will certainly not be what is now. It's just everyone tries to sell his ware, but it's not yet developed.
I'm not going to
but
let
it's
you speak.
Absolutely certain that it will be natural materials. We are
I'm
going
not,
back
I'm not going to
that.
Let you speak for too long, Leon, because I don't want to get people from the audience. Is that all right? Yes, somebody over there, and then somebody down here, and then somebody there. So this man here, with here. No. Yes, but you first.
Hi, Austin Williams. I'm with the Manifesto. I just wanted to sort of half agree with Alan's point that he seemed not to be on either side of this discussion. Not a don't know, but almost a don't agree. Because my starting point here is that even though modern architecture, whatever that might be, may look radical, it seemed to be shorn of any real radical content. So appearances can be deceiving. And I think that that's primarily maybe because it's being led by the nose by an awful lot of spreadsheets and quangos and government edicts and social policy directives. And also the kind of the environmental orthodoxy that Leon bangs on about, which seems to be this kind of cozy heartland where architects can now design buildings to carbon emissions criteria without actually bothering with the actual discussion of the intellectual content of what they're putting into the building. So it just seems to me that the modern side of the argument on this table seems to have lost the debate, because obviously Leon Krier and the kind of the reactionary content to the localist community-generated argument is the hallmark of the traditionalist. So I just think that the problem here in this discussion is that modernism has lost its nerve. The future, as Stephen pointed out, it seems to be a kind of a problematic place to be rather than somewhere aspirational. And therefore, we seem to be harking back to the past as almost like a cozy heartland where we can actually have our certainties. Maybe if modernism was a little bit more bold, a bit more risk-taking, then maybe we'd have a future in architecture.
Thank you. I think it would be helpful if people can hold the microphone a little bit away from their mouth, because it is quite difficult to hear sometimes. Yes, gentleman here.
Hello, is that good? It's Robert Adam. I'd just like to start off with a brief quote, and it goes this: public opinion will be led to adopt, without knowing it, proposals that we dare not present to them directly. That was Valéry Giscard d'Estaing talking about the EU constitution. And as we know from the Irish, Irish referendum, many of the our ruling elite don't want to talk to the public. We also know very well that the vast majority of people prefer traditional architecture, as Simon has mentioned. I'm sorry, Sean, but survey after survey after survey consistently demonstrates this. And why are architects not interested? Why, to quote Alain, are they not interested in reflecting their ideals? Because they're only interested in the opinions of other architects. What I object to most of all is the constant claim to own the present and the future. The present is what it is, and that includes popular desire for traditional architecture. That is modern. The future is not preordained, but what we make it, and that always includes the past. To say that good architecture must be something disliked by the public is an insult to the public, an abdication of social responsibility, an admission of creative failure. Of course, high culture is not made solely of the popular, but it is not the culture of the people unless it is theirs. Architects owe it to their public to design what they want and to make it better. Thank you.
Thank you. Somebody up in the balcony. A woman.
A woman. Hi. Unlike the last two people, I actually have a question, and it's a small question that may have large consequences. I'm an academically trained historian, so the question I need to ask is, what did His Royal Highness mean by modern, and what does each of you mean by modernism? Because no good debate can continue without either attempting to build consensus about your definition or without personally stating what each of your multiple definitions may be. Thank you.
I think if I ask each of the panelists to define modern, we may be here till the end of next week. But Simon, you've got it in a sentence, haven't you?
There is a confusion here. We use the word modernity, modern with a small m and modern with a big M, and I think it's important to clear it up. No one is against modern architecture. Architecture is what we build with. I'm in favor of modern architecture. We're discussing a particular style. It was a period when I think architecture was style-free. It pretended that you didn't have to refer back at all. It pretended that people didn't want you to refer back at all. That was the modern movement, and that is what we're really arguing about.
Thank you. Alan.
I think that the word modernity, the modern architecture, at one level it obviously alludes to buildings being built now. Another level it alludes to the almost the cliched concrete or white stucco, brutal kind of structure that we know from, it's a sort of architectural cliche. But I suppose I'm sticking up for a kind of architecture which is both recognizably in tune with some of the themes of its age, but doesn't necessarily slavishly follow what one might call high modernism as it developed principally in Germany after the First World War. So, and I guess I'm saying that there's many ways of building in modern times. If you take something like the Tate Modern, is that a modernist building? Is that a high modernist building? Or is that a building that's built now that just looks quite cool? We might, you know, have arguments about that. Tate Modern is incidentally an extremely popular building. It's also a building that, in its interior at least, is recognizably in the spirit of its age. And I'd like to argue that is one of the great successes, the success of the Tate Modern. It's one of the great successes of what I think is an intelligent contemporary architecture. And of course we have to consider the word intelligence in any definition, any workable definition of good modernism.
Prince of Wales would totally agree with that.
He doesn't like the Tate Modern. He doesn't like the Tate Modern. He's attacked the Tate Modern.
It's a very interesting question and almost impossible to answer succinctly. So there's what the Prince of Wales believes modernism is and what modernism might actually be. But to me, as I think everybody here agrees, I mean, we're not talking about styles, we're talking about attitudes. And modernist architects believe in making things new. They believe in the primacy of creativity and invention. And making things new doesn't mean you can't take, it seems to be, I use the literary imagery, talk about doggerel and pastiche. We don't admire writers who just copy. Why should we, making the most of contemporary possibilities in architecture, as Alain said, involves meaningful relationships with changes in society, the language we use, the technology we use, the materials we use. It's not about curlicues, gargoyles, fretworks, and spandrels. They were entirely guttae, metopes, and triglyphs. They were expressions of an earlier civilization.
But you say we use, but actually we, the people, don't have much say in what our towns look like any longer, do we?
That begs a lot of questions, doesn't it? I mean, did they ever? The Athenians didn't vote for the Parthenon.
Well, I think vernacular architecture was attuned, as somebody said, to I'm showing my colours. yes. Somebody here.
Hello, can you hear me? My name is Ralph Perry Robinson. I was a student at the Prince of Wales's Institute of Architecture 15 years ago. I was the token modernist at the Institute. I spent 15 years recovering from it, and I now design houses for the super rich in Wiltshire.
What do they look like?
They all look like the sort of houses that everybody would like to live in Wiltshire.
Haciendas?
No, they're actually quite agreeable things. My part of my recovery program is sitting on a mountain in mid Wales studying environmental architecture, which I do once a month. I'm wondering what the modern wing, who don't seem to address the environmental issues of architecture, have to say about sustainable and carbon-sensitive architecture, which the only person who has actually seemed to address that was one of my former tutors at the Prince of Wales Institute, Leon Creer.
Stephen, you wanted to say?
Yes, well, that's an extremely interesting point, but it's not actually what the emotion is about, I think. But I just wanted to say, when you're talking about the there's a mismatch, something which does betray what I would say was the philosophical vacuity of the people proposing the motion was raised by Robert Adam, the distinguished architect who spoke a little bit before. And I hope I'm not, Robert, giving away something privileged information. I remember you telling me that the very rich clients you work for in Hampshire, they like a bit of a Doric portico at the front, but they actually like minimalist modern interiors. Now, that seems to me an extraordinary betrayal of something. I mean, we'll have to ask you what. But there seems to be, I have a passion about, design has all forms of design, whether architecture design or Alan's taps, design has a sort of moral character. Now, what I mean by that is it has the same qualities as human beings have, honesty and truthfulness. Anything which it works well, whether it's a building or an object, has a sort of authenticity about it, I believe. And that's what modernists, they've often failed, but that's what modernists with a capital or lowercase m are always trying to achieve, something which speaks of the age.
Leon.
Well, I'm pained. I thought we would be a bit further by now. To come here and say they just copy, and we are creative is so imbecile and childish, because nature copies. Nature is an imitative system. Everything we do is copying. Now, to pretend that copying is being an imbecile is just imbecile. Nature doesn't work otherwise. You have been copied by two parents. No, otherwise you wouldn't exist. And thanks God, these people, they still look like people. That's how nature works, typologically and in a repetitive way.
Most of them.
Now, to pretend that because one uses one form of architecture, you are uncreative, and by using another, you suddenly become creative, is completely absurd. It is by using an instrument, by playing a piano, by drawing, by doing anything, that your talent come forth. You don't invent the computer. You don't invent the piano. Now, usually the people who invent the piano are not the people who write the music. But anyway, you know, these things are repetitive, and it's through repetition that excellence gets educated, and finally the new talent which is born uses these new instruments and plays with them sovereign. And it's the first generations who struggle with it. But to pretend that you can only be creative by reinventing architecture is a complete lie. If you look at the great star architects now, they copy each other. I mean, you know how little sources there are nowadays, whereas you look at the richness of traditional architecture around the world is just indescribable. You move 10 kilometers and you have a different architecture. Now you get the same architecture all around the globe. So where is the rich and creative pattern? It's, you know, it's the traditional systems which are absolutely unavoidable. Mathematics, science, all the things we use are imitative, are copying things, and it's through copying that your genius or your talent finally comes forth.
Let me take another point. And I'm aware that you were asking about materials and how important at the present time it is to think of sustainability materials, and maybe somebody else would like to take that up either on the panel or in the audience in a moment. Yes.
I would actually have a question for the people for the motion. I think there's a distinction to be made between and type of what role we want to give to architecture, whether it's institutional architecture or housing. And I think Alain actually made a very interesting point, which is what values do we want to portray through architecture? And Winston Churchill made a very interesting comment in 1941 when the House of Lords was bombed, which was, we shape our buildings, and our buildings shape us. And what was a very controversial move was that he voted for the House of Lords to be reconstructed in the identical. And not because it was comfortable, precisely because it was an uncomfortable building that would remind people of the trauma that the country had gone through. And my question would be, do you think that you can have a progressive vision of society by building traditional institutional architecture?
Roger.
Yes, I do think that we can have a perfectly acceptable society housed within buildings of a traditional kind, and I think nothing has been said that points in another direction. Alain de Botton gave us some extremely interesting examples of what he regarded as successful modern architecture, including the Queen's Building at Cambridge, where it is quite obvious that it had become successful because it has learnt that a tradition is an organic thing that must be connected to the past if it is to say anything new. And I think that this is a general truth about human society, that we can't actually be comfortable in the present if we think we have no roots in the past. And if we simply live in the present moment as though nothing had come before us, then we're not actually living as human beings.
Thank you. Yes, somebody up there in a balcony.
Mark Archer. We've heard a lot about blaming architects, but what about blaming the patrons? And I just wonder if the panel has any comments about patronage and the role that plays. I mean, we've heard that a lot of poor modernist work was commissioned by public servants. We've seen some good examples of houses, modernist houses, built by very rich people. But how do we, if every age gets the architecture it deserves, how do architects get the patrons they deserve?
Simon, you've written a lot about this.
I mean, who is the patron of a building? Surely it's the person who lives in it. The people who live in houses now, go and look, depressing though it may be to the architectural profession, go and look at the new estates spreading across Essex and Cambridge and Ely and so on. They are all traditional in style. They're traditional in style because people have had enough frankly, of modern movement, I use this term very carefully, development of urban centres. We heard a lot about the Barbican. How many people here ever go for a stroll on a Sunday afternoon through the Barbican?
Well, I think the answer to that is
some valiant at the back. And I wonder how many go for a stroll through Notting Hill. I mean, the fact of the matter is, and this is not something about modern architecture as such, it's about a particular style that I believe was a cultural cul-de-sac that has dominated English architecture for the past 50 years, but only a particular branch of English architecture. You never see a slide at an architecture seminar of a British housing estate from the private sector in which people actually want to go and live. They ban it. It doesn't appear. It's forbidden. It's shameful. All you see are unbelievably rich Japanese building daft houses that will fall down in 6 months.
Now, I'm not on either side of this debate, I promise you, but I do have a joke, which was a cartoon, and it was a woman at a missing persons bureau looking for her child who'd got lost, and the policeman behind the missing persons bureau counter said, "Have you tried the Barbican?" Yes.
Stuart Lipton, I'm a developer, but I don't build icons, as Simon will tell you. I'd just like to pick up this patron point. Good patrons are here in the UK. What do? I think they express love and care for their projects. And Simon, there are plenty of modern projects to walk through. You can walk through Broadgate in the city. More people walk there than any other project in the city. You can walk through Chiswick Park by Richard Rogers, perhaps a reinvention of the Georgian Villa. You can walk through many projects, Paternoster Square. There are many in London. What happens, unfortunately, is that the planning system doesn't allow us to build what we should really be building. And we can't... we can't let this conversation go by without referring to the planning system. It's bogged down our quality, it's bogged down our lives, it's produced the lowest common denominator of design, it certainly doesn't encourage quality, as Sean has said, and it certainly hasn't produced wonderful places. And I'm rather disappointed that great places, parks, squares, have not figured in the context. I think we had one comment about them from the panel. Surely in this country, what we need is great places. The buildings are almost incidental. Don't worry about them.
Thank you, Stuart. Which is very much Richard Rogers' theme, isn't it? That great places to walk and be. Sorry.
I mean, I think the argument that no one really wants, if there's a choice, no one really wants modernist architecture is really contentious, because there's basically not very much choice, as Stuart was suggesting. I mean, we're living in a world, it's rather like a Soviet supermarket, where everyone's really buying some revolting tin of food, and then there's a poll done about who likes the revolting food, and that food comes relatively near the top, because there's nothing else. So people are buying pastiche, bad architecture of the kind that Simon seems to like, not because they like it, but because nothing else on the market. So it's not until we get a true proliferation. I mean, the other thing to mention is Kevin MacLeod and Grand Designs. Now, what happens with Grand Designs? Grand Designs is the first offering. It's like the first sort of modern British restaurant to open in the UK in, say, 1982. People flock to it. People are desperate. It's got the highest viewing figures of any program on Channel 4 bar Big Brother. This is clearly not a sign that contemporary architecture is unpopular. People constantly, I know this, people constantly, after every showing of Grand Designs, people call up Channel 4 and say, where can I buy this? And the answer is nowhere, and the reason is because of the planning system and the timidity of developers. Every now and then a developer does take a huge risk, as the developer Accordia did in Cambridge, and builds a wonderful, modern development, and it sells like hotcakes, much faster than the sort of subprime, unsellable stuff that's now sitting on the in the badlands of Essex. So I think that argument about popularity really needs to be used with care.
Yes.
I'm Ruth Lang. I'm just finishing my training as an architect at the moment. One of the arguments for the motion was that we speak English, but we're not actually retrospective imbeciles. Isn't it the case, though, that language is evolving every day to reflect society and accommodate new technological advances? And shouldn't architecture, therefore, be doing the same thing?
Thank you. Stephen.
Yes, absolutely. That's my own conviction. This is why I find the arguments coming from the people who are supporting the motion so stultifying. I mean, I don't want to get trapped into details about sustainability or plan, all the things which you said, what Alan said before and Stuart said before. Plan is absolutely correct. But for me, the issue here is about the absolute fundamental primacy of the need to make something new. And I know Bart Simpson, yes, said that, you know, trying is the first step towards failure. And we've had lots of failures in modern architecture, but it seems to me to be the principle is wrong and we're right because it's important and humane to try to make things new.
Roger.
I believe. Yeah, I think that this is a pernicious platitude that novelty is the essence of the modern, and that if we don't pursue novelty, we're in some way becoming stagnant, mired in the past and unable to cope with the modern world. If you look back at the greatest period of what I think is the greatest period of vernacular architecture in Europe, which was the Renaissance and what immediately followed it, that was an extremely novel thing in one respect, but it was also an attempt to recapture a tradition and to develop a vocabulary that would have an organic sense of its own and that would permit constant development of the kind that Leon Krier was defending. And I think we should just get rid of this dichotomizing mentality. It says we are either new or we're old. The whole point of a tradition is that it's a developing thing that owes its life to what went before. And only if you accept that can you have any conception of what you're doing towards the future.
Thank you.
My name is Jan Masiak. I'm an architect. I have to say that in a sense, I'm sort of disappointed by this evening's discussion, and I share Leon's frustration with, in a sense, the frippery that's been going on in discussing architecture, where we are in the early part of the 21st century. There are some very serious issues that, in a sense, Prince Charles wasn't aware of back in the 80s when he made his famous speech at Hampton Court. And one of the key ones that we really do have to address is what Leon brought up, which is the whole issue of peak oil, the running out of resources, and the need for us to build buildings that are sustainable. And the key part of sustainability is longevity. And that's something that modernism has never addressed. And in fact, we've had examples of great modernism all from the 1940s and 50s, as far as I can tell. The stuff doesn't last, and it needs huge amounts of resources, not only to build, but then to maintain and repair. Now, that's something that is going to come up behind us and, in a sense, take this argument beyond a question of styles to one of survivability. And if you go back to a tradition, it isn't nostalgia. It is going back to the last good setting of where things were sustainable. The guys that built the old cities and the old towns had no choice. They had to build in a manner that meant they didn't go bankrupt in an energy sense. And we have had a great party. It's been good fun for the last 60 years, but it's got to end. Now, the question I want to ask is, at what point will the panel who are for modernist architecture actually acknowledge that?
Sean.
It's interesting, the whole kind of point about style, about sustainability, about patronage and procurement. I mean, I agree with Simon about modernism being a style, which means that it goes in and out of fashion. You can build sustainable buildings in a modern style. You can build sustainable buildings in a traditional style. You can build sustainable buildings in any style you want. That's not the issue. I mean, for example, if you use a material like concrete, you're told that that is a bad material to use environmentally. When in fact, if you look at carbon footprint, only 3% of our individual carbon footprint is made up of the materials that make up the built environment that we live in. Whereas something like 10 to 15% is in the use of buildings, regardless of how they're made. Similarly, if you want to reduce your carbon footprint, you should worry less about the buildings you're inhabiting and how many times you're going to Australia on an aeroplane, or for that matter to Malaga on an aeroplane, or for that matter to Manchester on an aeroplane.
But Sean, many modern buildings have sealed windows and a very expensive air conditioning system.
Of course,
that's not really sustainable.
Because those buildings were built using an ideology from the 1960s and 70s. The buildings of the future.
No, buildings today are being built like that.
That's because that's what the market requires. Again, it's not an issue, I think, of style or of, you know, whether it looks like a Corbusier building.
It's an issue of materials.
It like
the question was about materials.
But it's materials can be, you know, you can use a brick, which, to all intents and purposes, is a sustainable material. But if you transport it 400 miles from Scotland or across the ocean, it's less sustainable. I think these things are not to do whether it's modernist or whether it's traditional. In fact, I think the issue is not modernist or traditional. It's to do with the quality, it's to do with the sustainability, it's to do with a whole series of issues that have nothing to do with style. That's why I think this whole debate's rather anachronistic.
Stephen, well, I think that's exactly the point. I mean, I don't take second place to anybody in my interest in sustainable issues. Anybody concerned with technology wouldn't want it any other way. I mean, what the world needs, I personally believe, is more technology, but not less. But technology tends to be more and more efficient. That's, you know. But anyway, sustainability is absolutely fine. But I just keep everybody keeps on getting away from what the motion is, that the modern architect. The motion is, modern architecture, the Prince of Wales says, is carbuncles and stumps. It's manifestly, simply, not the case. It's not about style either. We've said this. I mean, it was said repeatedly. The questions from the floor keep on coming back, accusing us of doing some sort of style mongering. It's not that at all. I mean, it is modern architecture. It's an attitude. It's that thing that it's that belief that you can. It's that belief in creativity and not relying on the prop of the past. It's about having respect for the past. And some sort of belief in the future. And I find the arguments which are negative about the future rather than.
I mean, to pretend that these people don't rely on the past is just a lie. You can trace any shape used by a modernist architect, the most creative so-called, today, you can trace it to past events, because all experience with nature is past.
Well, of course, culture is an entirely.
There is no experience in the future.
Thing. Of course it is.
All experience is past, so whatever we base on experience is passéist. It's a ridiculous argument,
Simon.
Stephen.
It's immature.
I think it's important to just for a second on the politics of it. This particular style that we're discussing emerged from a particular political climate between the wars. It took hold of a particular profession, that of architect. It infected the rebuilding of Europe after the war. I learnt my, insofar as I know it as an amateur in architecture, sitting at the feet of Graham Shankland in Liverpool when he presented his plan for the new Liverpool to Liverpool City Council. He proposed to pull down Liverpool. And I remember thinking, this man is completely crazy. He was hired by Liverpool City Council, and he pulled down half of Liverpool. That was the attitude of mine to which I object. That is authoritarian, it is not democratic. It is totally subject to evolution. We have indeed moved on from it. One of the great things about modern architecture with a small m is it's moved on from it, seen the fault of that way. But that was a cul-de-sac, a dangerous authoritarian cul-de-sac. Let's not let them get away with it.
I have a question here from perhaps our youngest member.
Hi, I'm Freddie Walshaw. I have 3 points for people for the motion. Firstly, surely you need to respect the originality of so many modern buildings in this day. And secondly, surely modern architecture isn't just an influence and a response to the ideas of the modern world. And finally, with old buildings, surely the past is gone and you need to open your mind to the future.
Thank you. Can I ask you if you're going to be an architect? You are. Good. Yes, somebody here wants to make a point. Man with behind you.
My name is Quinlan Terry.
I've already been insulted by a picture of one of my buildings on the thing. I really think a lot of nonsense has been talking about the, particularly on the right-hand side, about materials, because in the past they used materials which did not depend on burning up the resources of the earth, stone, brick, lime mortar, timber, and slate, all of which the modernist establishment eschew. And one of the things I feel the main point, and getting back to the main point of the issue of whether Prince Charles was right, and I think I need to instruct the people in this room who haven't been to an architectural school, but I had the misfortune to go to the AA in the 50s, and as Simon Jenkins said, it was after the war, everybody thought that everybody must be modern. There were about three of us who couldn't quite see why we had to be, and we produced traditional schemes, very bad traditional schemes, and finally, we were told by Peter Smithson, you're undermining the whole principle of the modern movement, and therefore, if you do your final scheme in the modern style, you will fail. And I don't think people realize how students have been forced into this mold of doing the modern style. It's an architect's thing. The public don't realize. And of course, when you've done 5 years of modern architects, you come out and you're incapable of doing anything else. Thank you.
Well, the last speaker was absolutely right, and there are appalling absurdities and like that. But that's no more corrupting and wicked than architects a century ago being required to do Beaux-Arts designs. There's always been a prevailing orthodoxy, and that orthodoxy, the last questioner from the floor described, has long since gone.
I need to take one more point from the floor and then ask the speakers to sum up. Yes.
My name is Christopher Rogers. I'm not an architect either. In having this debate, we know that we're not doing anything new, and we know that neither side can win. If we go back to the 1660s, we've got the same debate with Wren deciding he wants to knock down half of the city to build his great avenues from St. Paul's. And, of course, the result was a compromise. He got a bit of it, but he didn't get to knock down all the churches and rebuild them in his new grand plan. He followed the same street plans as were there before, or the 1840s with Ruskin, the debate between the organic and the classical. We enjoy this sort of debate, and we know which side we're on at the start, and we need this debate to keep moving forward, but we know that neither side can win.
Sean?
Yeah. Yes.
No, I just wondered whether you wanted the last word from the
platform. Okay, no, I will have the last word. Now, I wanted to say something about authoritarian tendencies, which have just been raised in a number of in different manners. Most great architecture that we admire today is the result of hideous authoritarian tendencies. The Gothic cathedrals were built by the medieval Catholic Church, not known for their liberalism, as I recall it. In fact, they formed magnificent backdrops for burning people at the stake, I think it would be historically true to say. One thinks of some of my favorite architecture. I love Baroque architecture, and Baroque architecture is the architecture of the Counter-Reformation, which is also, I think, about burning people at the stake a lot of the time, certainly not allowing them to think freely. You can walk through the boulevards of Paris and enjoy them. Of course, they were driven through by Baron Haussmann, ostensibly to provide hygiene for the working classes, but also handily to move troops around the city in order that those working classes could be handily suppressed. So there is always a relationship between authoritarianism and architecture, and unfortunately, it actually does produce some rather good architecture.
Well, thank you. Thank you in the audience very much for some absolutely wonderful points. I know there are other people who wanted to speak, and I'm sorry there isn't time, but it's time to vote now. Now, will you please get out your cards, and you can tear them in half if you want to definitely vote for or against, or if you still haven't made up your mind, just put the whole ticket in the box when it comes round. Now, whilst you're doing that, the speakers are going to sum up, so if you could do it with the minimum amount of noise, I'd be grateful. And also, whilst Just before I ask the speakers, I'm going to ask each of the speakers how old the house is that they live in. Leon, how old is the house you live in?
It's difficult to say. A few hundred years.
A few hundred years.
Son. It was redone in 1900. To sum up, I think...
Don't sum up yet. Mm. No,
would you just
no,
ask the
not
question?
Yet.
Mm. No, 1900. Mm.
1900. Simon, when was your house built?
1840.
Roger?
Probably 1720.
Stephen?
1834, but I'd tear it down, but the planners won't allow me to.
Alan?
Yes, very regrettably, 1900, but I hope one day 2008.
Sean?
2002, and I did it myself.
Thank you. Right, let the voting go on now. We're going to take the speakers in reverse order to sum up for 2 minutes each. Sean, you're first.
Okay. I think the main point I was trying to make, and I don't think I would change my view on it on the basis of the debate, was that... that this argument's rather anachronistic. I tried to point out that it was going on even before I entered architecture school. It's still going on today. And why just modern v. traditional? There are all kinds of different styles and approaches to architecture these days. Why are we still arguing this, essentially about a kind of 1960s type architecture versus an 1800s type architecture? I think what's great about architecture today and the potential that it has is that there are all kinds of different approaches. And I for one, welcome places like Poundbury, which Leon designed, probably for not the reasons he would like me to welcome it. I kind of rather like the fact that it has to deal with the motor car, which makes it really kind of odd in a sort of David Lynch kind of way, sort of kind of spooky. But I rather like that about it. I'm not sure Leo would quite agree with that. But I think styles change, preferences changed. I was rather surprised, pleasantly, to hear that most of the audience in here, at the beginning at least, were in favour of modern architecture. I'm sure that wouldn't have been the case in 1984 had we been having this debate shortly after the Prince of Wales had made his speech. But I think really what's really important are all of the other issues. We've got great modern architecture, we've got great traditional architecture, we've got great Baroque architecture. The stuff that we're building today, most of it is crap, and it's to do with the hideous procurement mechanisms, it's to do with terrible space standards, it's to do with terrible, ill-informed planners, and these are the issues we should be really addressing, and we can have good architecture of any style whatsoever if we can deal with those issues.
Thank you. Leon Krier, 2 minutes.
Well, I think you are extremely lucky country to have somebody like the Prince of Wales, because there's been no leader around the world who has had that sort of courage to talk about something which was scandalously wrong. Now, to revert to a reasonable, intelligent system of producing cities and environments cannot be done just like that. Because first of all, the profession was not ready, and science is not ready. Because science looked into extreme scales, into the micro scale and macro scale, and didn't look at how our countries were messed up with unbelievable wastage of energies and lives. The suburban dilution of cities and the metropolitan hyper-concentration are futureless creatures, and they will collapse with the increase in oil of the price of oils. And then will come the day when things can be discussed seriously. I mean, we are still bloated and behave like spoiled children. No.
Thank you. Alain, 2 minutes.
This feels like a very British debate, and the reason why this debate would really surprise anyone from Switzerland, the country I grew up in a 1962 modern concrete beautiful house, is that it wouldn't occur to anyone in many contemporary European countries to argue for old-fashioned architecture, because there's not such a debate. Modernism is not frightening, and the reason why modernism isn't frightening is because there have been a succession of very talented modern architects. The reason why modernism got into trouble in the UK is that it was handled by some very poor architects working with some very bad local planners and very bad construction teams, and that's why it got into trouble. So it's important to remember, if you It's important to remember that if you love traditional architecture, most traditional architecture being built looks like Poundbury. And with all due respect to Leon Creer, Poundbury does not honor the true principles of good architecture. It is a pastiche. That means a betrayal of the principles of good architecture. If you want good architecture that remembers the past, look at someone like Sir Michael Hopkins, who knows... Yes, I have. Thank you. If you look at the architecture of someone like Sir Michael Hopkins, he is a man deeply infused with tradition who nevertheless does not want to build pastiche. The Prince of Wales has routinely rebuked him, but anyone who looks at, say, the Queen's building that I mentioned will realize that there is an alternative between this uncomfortable dichotomy, on the one hand pastiche, on the other hand brutal modern. There is a middle way, and that middle way is an intelligent modernism that it does definitely remember the past, that gets away from the cliches of the 1960s, that doesn't look like Trellick Tower, which I think is a good thing, and looks like something that we can all love, that those who admire the past can love, and those who admire modern construction and modern themes in architecture can always love. So I think we're used
Time's
to...
Time's up.
Yeah, that's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sorry to interrupt you. Simon.
I've never understood why the word pastiche always applies to traditional architecture, but never to Mies van der Rohe. Everything Norman Foster builds, is, apart from the wonderful gherkin, is pastiche Mies van der Rohe. You can't do a pastiche of a modernist building because they all look the same. It is true, as I think I forget who said, that authoritarianism has ruled architecture a very long time. The point about authoritarianism is that it's, in its essence, dangerous. It's somebody telling somebody else what's going to be good for them. The architecture that we're discussing, that's what might be called good modernism, is invariably a big, iconic building. The modern movement hated streets. Street hatred was its characteristic. That's why there are no streets in the Barbican. People love streets. Jane Jacobs was right. Streets are the essence of good-mannered urbanism. I have no problem at all with modern architecture fitted into a street. The street imposes its own discipline, its own tradition, its own style on a modern building. There's no problem with that at all. It's the hatred for the street that the modern movement so often demonstrated, expecting people to walk across great windswept spaces in between their bloody monuments. That's what was wrong with the modern movement.
Thank you. Stephen.
Well, I'd agree with Simon Jenkins, if only he was right. His, like the Prince of Wales, I'm afraid Simon's view is really rather simplistic and dated. He's also wrong about, people do like living in good, well-designed new buildings, if they have the chance, and anybody's been fortunate enough, I don't want to, or I will, raise the spirit of the demonized Le Corbusier again. Everybody who's actually stayed in the Unité d'Habitation in Marseille knows that it's a heroic, handsome, comfortable, and delightful place. And it be that as it may, I'm against we keep on wandering off the motion, but I oppose the motion for the very simple reason that the Prince of Wales's rhetoric has been crude and distorted. It's skewed the debate. The argument, and I think everybody's in agreement here, the argument shouldn't be between modern traditional, but it should be between, what's good and what's bad. It's all about, it must ultimately be about quality. That said, I do find the soulless and illiterate historicism proposed by the Prince of Wales and his architectural admirers dismaying. I much prefer the spirits of inquiry and invention, which I think the best contemporary architecture has. Remember, making things new is a defining aspect of civilization. Said to condemn modern architecture is to condemn the creative spirit itself. I find the motion stultifying because creativity is humane, making things new is humane, and like intelligence, it always wants to move forward, not backwards.
Thank you. And finally, Roger. Yeah,
the modern movement was introduced with a piece of pretentious rhetoric saying that architecture must express the spirit of the age. We've seen this banal idea lent upon by the other side throughout their argument. We ought to know how novel and parochial that idea is. Architecture throughout human history has not tried to express the spirit of the age, it's tried to express the eternal reality of the human spirit as such.
And I think this is something that you'll find in the mosques of Sinan just as much as you find it in the Gothic churches built in Europe. And I think that we must get away from that kind of rhetoric and recognize that if people have reacted against modern architecture, it's because they have felt that it's an architecture which refuses the human spirit, that in some way it is anti-human. And now, Alain de Botton said that architecture must know where it is, and he showed a picture of the only agreeable prospect in Nagasaki by way of refuting what people like Quinlan Terry and Leo Krier do. And I think that is true. Architecture must know where it is, but that where is precisely what architecture creates. And if we just think that there is a where that we are, independently of the buildings that we put in it, we actually betray the cause of architecture. We build, as I said, in order to dwell, and that means making a somewhere out of nowhere. And I think that the modern vernacular styles have made a nowhere out of somewhere.
Thank you. Do we have a result? Not yet. How long will the result be? Long as a piece of string. Well, we will talk amongst ourselves. I've asked the members of the panel how old the houses are that they live in. It's interesting that most of them live in, apart from Sean, who built his own, most of them live in old houses. And there does seem to be a movement amongst my children's generation, they're 26 and 23, to start looking at houses in places like Holland and Finland, where there is houses that they can afford, which are very beautifully built and are completely sustainable and aren't going to use much energy. So maybe the new generation are going to say, these are the sort of houses we built, combining both things, beauty and sustainability. But I don't know what sort of houses you all live in or what sort of houses you want to live in or whether you like streets. Like, yes, do you want to make a comment? Can you hear?
No.
Is it, have we still got a microphone? Just wait till the microphone gets to you. This is an article in the...
It was an article in the Times about 10, 15 years ago, and it showed photographs of about 8 period houses, and they all, without exception, were lived in by the most famous architects in the land, including Richard Rogers, whose house I know very well. And
can you hold the microphone near to your mouth?
Yes, Richard Rogers lives in a period house and he actually got permission to gut it. Yes. Something that most of us who live in period houses wouldn't be allowed to.
But Norman Foster doesn't. And
Norman
Gehry
Foster
doesn't,
lives too. Actually outside St. Moritz in a period house in a nature reserve in a national park.
Thank you. I wanted to ask somebody why most great architects are left-handed, but that's another debate altogether, I think. How many architects, can we see how many architects there are in the audience? Would you put your hands up, please? Quite a goodly collection.
You can always tell you've got an audience of architects, because if you insult planning, you get a round of applause.
How many planners are in the audience? Only one person brave enough to put their hand up, and they're way back in the...
Well,
how many textual historians in the audience? Architectural historians? 2, 3, 4, 5? Well, I think we've done that. I won't ask about coal miners and bank managers, but I'm sure they're well represented. Now, the debate result before the debate was for the motion, 199, against the motion, 365, and don't knows, 119. Just let me remind you of the motion. Prince Charles was right, modern architecture is still all glass stumps and carbuncles. After the debate, for the motion, 266, against the motion, 391, and don't knows, 29. So many of you were swayed. I must congratulate all the speakers who spoke against the motion and swayed you so beautifully, and thank you for being a great audience. Thank you very much indeed.